ॐ नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय। ॐ नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय। ॐ नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय। नारायणं नमस्कृत्य नरं चैव नरोत्तमं देवीं सरस्वतीं व्यासं ततो जयमुदीरये नष्टप्रायेषु अभद्रेषु नित्यं भागवत सेवया भगवतीरुत्तमश्लोके भक्तिर्भवति नैष्टिकी कृष्णाय वासुदेवाय देवकी नंदनाय च नंदगोपकुमाराय गोविंदाय नमो नमः। हरे कृष्णा। सो वेलकम ऑल ऑफ यू टू श्रीमद् भागवतम डिस्कशन इन द मॉर्निंग। टुडे वी आर रीडिंग फ्रॉम श्रीमद् भागवतम कैंटो 9 चैप्टर 1 किंग सुदुम्ना बिकम्स अ वुमन। टेक्स्ट नंबर 40। आचार्यानुग्रहात् कामं लब्ध्वा पुंस्त्वं व्यवस्थया पालयामास जगतिं नाभ्य नंदन स्मतं प्रजाः। आचार्यानुग्रहात् कामं लब्ध्वा पुंस्त्वं व्यवस्थया पालयामास जगतिं नाभ्यनंदन स्मतं प्रजाः। आचार्य अनुग्रहात् बाय द मर्सी ऑफ द स्पिरिचुअल मास्टर कामं डिजायर्ड लब्ध्वा हैविंग अचीव्ड पुंस्वाम मेलनेस व्यवस्थया बाय दिस सेटलमेंट ऑफ लॉर्ड शिवा पालयाम आस ही रूल्ड जगतिम द होल वर्ल्ड न अभ्यनंदन स्म वर नॉट सैटिस्फाइड विथ तम टू द किंग प्रजा द सिटीजन्स। ट्रांसलेशन दस बीइंग फेवर्ड बाय द स्पिरिचुअल मास्टर अकॉर्डिंग टू द वर्ड्स ऑफ लॉर्ड शिवा Sudyumna regained his desired maleness every alternate month and in this way ruled the kingdom, although the citizens were not satisfied with this. Purport: the citizens could understand that the king was transformed into a female every alternate month, therefore could not discharge his royal duty. Consequently, they were not very satisfied. Hare Krishna. Please bless me. Umagyanatimirandhasya gyananjana shalakaya chakshurun militam yena tasmai sri guruve namaha sri chaitanya manovishtam stapitam yena bhutale स्वयं रूपक कदा मह्यं ददाति स्वपदांतिकं। श्रीकृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधर श्रीवासदि गौर भक्त वृंद। हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे हरे Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Thank you very much for letting me sit here and speak Bhagavatam. I'm grateful to all of you. So, a brief summary of this chapter, 9th canto, chapter 1. Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Rama Rama. So from Garbhodaka Shai Vishnu, Brahma was born. Brahma's mind gave birth to Marichi Muni. And then Kashyap was born. He married Aditi. And Vivaswan, the sun god, was born. And the sun god from Samnya Devi gave birth to Shraddha Deva. Shraddha Deva Manu is also called as Vaivaswata Manu. He married Shraddha Devi and got 10 sons like King Nraga, King Ikshvaku, the famous Ikshvaku king. In previous life, Shraddha Dev was Satyavrat from Dravid Desh. He was King Satyavrata from Dravid Desh. And he attained the position of Manu in the next life because of his austerities and service. But interesting to know that before begetting 10 sons, he had one daughter. And the story goes like this, that the yajna was being performed to attain a son, to get a son. But somewhere in between, the queen Shraddha Devi met the priest and told in his ears that, "I want a daughter." And because of that, the priest chanted some different mantras. And because of that, a girl baby was conceived. And the king did not know when the baby was born. He understood that she is a girl. And he was not very happy. And then he met Vasishtha Muni, that is not happy to have a girl, he wants to have a boy. Sounds very familiar in our life. I will speak about it little later. So then Vasishtha Muni prayed to the Supreme Personality of Godhead. And Vasishtha Muni is described in Mahabharata also as a Dvitiya Brahma. He is such a powerful personality. He is like second Brahma. Is extremely powerful. So because of his devotion and position, Supreme Personality of Godhead was very pleased. And on his request, Supreme Personality of Godhead, Sri Krishna, transformed the girl Ila into the boy Sudumna. Amazing situation. And as Ila was also, she was very beautiful, as Sudumna also, the king was very, very beautiful. Then he assumed the kingdom, he became a king. And one time he was going to a forest. That forest is called as Sukumara forest in Mount Sumeru. And there, that place is supposed to be a place to for Lord Shiva to meet his wife Uma Devi, Parvati Devi, to have conjugal relationships. So that place is like a prohibited area, you can say private area, or private space of Lord Shiva and his wife. And one time when some rishis came, and that time they were in union, so Parvati Devi was very embarrassed. So Lord Shiva that time, to please her, declared that anyone who comes who's in male form in this area will become female. So he will not have to become any more embarrassed. And this was not known to Sudumna when he entered the forest. And he entered in the forest with so many his soldiers and ministers, and instantly all of them became women. And they were very embarrassed. Now they could not go back to kingdom. So they went on going ahead and ahead. And then it is said that she, it goes on like this in this pastime. It's a very amazing pastime. It also depicts our life. Anyway, so the son of Chandra Devata, that is Somdev, that is moon, his son is Buddha, that we worship as a graha on Wednesday. Today is Wednesday, so Buddha, this Buddha Dev got attracted to this lady now, and she also was enamored by his beauty, and they united, and King Pururava was born. And then Lord Shiva blessed Sudumna again to become woman one day, 1 month, and to become man 1 month. It's a very tricky story actually, Srimad Bhagavatam. Whenever I have, how many times I have read this story, it's a very tricky story. I have not yet fully understood the purport of the story, but there are some very significant points to study and understand. Is that whatever destiny is, will always will have its effect. The destiny was that Ila was supposed to be a girl, but then some intervention was done, divine intervention, superior intervention, and some compromise was made. But again, after some time, that turned into the previous destiny. And then again some prayers were done, again some intervention was done, but again, completely being woman, this factor was not annihilated, not nullified. That factor remained till the whole life of this soul, I would say. Not, I will not say any man or woman or Sudumna or Ila. This soul had to remain in female body for sure in this lifetime. So again and again we see that finally 1 month man, 1 month woman. And that's how the life continued. When he was man, he begot 10 sons. They became the next famous kings. As a woman, he was in between resting. He could not do his kingly duties because in those days, kings could not be women. So, I remember when I was just married, I also was very, very keen to have a son. And when first baby was born as daughter, I was quite upset. So, I was kind of identifying with this. But in the course of time, we accepted the desire of the Lord, and the life continued. Maybe if that time son was born, maybe there would be overt attachment, too much attachment because of the desire is fulfilled and the attachment is there. So everything is ordained by the Lord for the perfect progress of every living entity, specifically human beings. Every single thing is perfectly tailor-made by the Lord for that particular individual's progress towards the lotus feet of the Lord Himself. When we understand it, life becomes very smooth. There is no sorrow or grief. And when we struggle with our desire, with the Lord's desire, then lot of struggle comes in between. Lot of pain comes in between, difficulties come in between. And what is hidden in the arrangement of the Lord, the mercy, the benefit that we are supposed to receive, that is compromised. And when we say, yes, my Lord, then all that is planned by the Lord to give us is made fully available to us. That means our patra, our pot, if it is ready to accept by the dint of surrender, then that pot will receive the complete mercy that is designed in that particular event. Otherwise, we will lose, or we will get percentage of that if we struggle with that. So the ideal situation is not to struggle with the arrangement of the Lord which are perfect, but to accept them as they are. And this is only possible when we associate with great souls, Mahatma. Syan Mahasthevaya Vipra Punyatirtha Nishevanat. When we genuinely take shelter of Mahatmas, the great souls, then this activity, which is very difficult because our nature is to conquer and control and enjoy, and our goal is to become servant and be controlled and be enjoyed. In that struggle, it becomes difficult in the material world. But with the mercy of the association of pure devotees and by serving them, these difficult things gradually becomes easy. And it, one time comes, it becomes very natural to just accept everything which comes on the way. Another factor is that being a man and being a woman. Ultimately, the soul is by nature we have heard in the beginning, you correct me if I'm wrong, that we are all females actually. Because who is a female? By definition in scriptures, that one who is enjoyed by the enjoyer is described as female. So we may be in male body, but as spirit soul being part and parcel of the Lord, we are to be enjoyed by the Lord. Our life, our activities, our thoughts, our existence is supposed to be in service to the Lord, and our service Lord is supposed to enjoy. And that is a perfect situation, whether in spiritual world, in the material world, to be engaged in service to the Lord. It's a natural, harmonious condition. But this body is never without effect. For example, if some soul is in tiger's body, then naturally it will be aggressive. And some soul is in the goat's body, naturally it is fearful. Or you see squirrel always running with fear, or sparrow always running with fear. What to speak of body? Suppose you are sitting in a big truck and somebody sitting in a small motorcycle or small rickshaw. Even the person who is sitting in that big truck thinks he is a big man, you know, and who is this insignificant creature who is going in rickshaw. So even that dead body, that is truck, not live, also has effect on your consciousness. To that extent we are affected by our coverings. So one covering is mind, body, intelligence. Another covering is the Panchamahabhuta made body, the external body, Stula Sharira. And then whatever coverings we accept on that, maybe in the form of car or a house or the clothes we wear or the position we adopt or the influence we adopt or the authority we adopt, the domain we adopt, the control we adopt, all these coverings do affect our consciousness and make us behave the way our coverings are. If we are, suppose, director, then that director's position will make us behave like director and treat people in that particular manner. Or if we are a watchman, then we behave accordingly. So ultimately we should understand that all this has happened because we rebelled against Lord. In the kingdom of Lord, everybody was in a natural position of being servant. There was no issue, there was no problem. But we rebelled against the Lord, and because of the rebellion against the Lord, this particular body he has achieved. Fall down in the material world is happened, and this body is forcefully, like the uniform of jail, has been forced upon us. Because why it is said we forced upon us? Because we are not choosers. We want to have a fair, tall, beautiful, straight nose, lotus-eyed body. But we don't get. That is why it is forced. If we can choose, then it is not forced. So there is no choice. We are given this body just because of one sin that we have done, that we have rebelled against the Lord. And because of that, three modes of material nature are acting upon us. Three kinds of miseries make us suffer like anything. Repeated birth and old age and disease and death takes place. We are forced to act in under three modes of nature. So activities result into karmas, and we get entangled in suffering and enjoyment as a result of our activities. Punya phala, papa phala. And this goes on. This goes on eternally. Then there is lot of stock of pap punya, which make us go to hell, heaven, animal, bird, other species, human beings, poor human being, rich human being, beautiful human being, or ugly human being. There are so many complications, ramifications, that life just goes on in the material world as if it is eternal time. It's never ending. The list is never ending. What to suffer, what to enjoy, as per our karmas. And all this is happening because of rebellion against the Lord. So if you want to stop this, the only method is to again unite with the Lord in service. To let ourselves willingly fall at the feet of the Lord and His devotees and accept our position as being servant of the Lord and act accordingly. Not say something and act differently. Like if somebody becomes doctor, then he has to practice as a doctor and treat people's body and cure them. Then you can see he has realized he's being a doctor. But if he becomes doctor and then starts to steal business, that means he has become a doctor but not realized his position as a doctor. So similarly, we may speak that I'm not this body, I'm spirit soul, I'm part and parcel of the Lord, and I'm supposed to serve the Lord, I'm supposed to serve the devotees, and this is perfection of life. And I keep on speaking this, but I never practice this. That means I have not realized what I am speaking, or what I have read, what I have heard. So it is very important to finally conclude once and for all in this lifetime, not waiting for more lifetimes. In this lifetime itself, at an opportune, fortunate time, we should decide that I am a servant of the Lord and I have to act in the way of service to devotees and the Lord, finally. The Lord I don't know now, but I know devotees, I meet devotees. I have a devotee who is my spiritual master. So I need to serve. And then we serve part-time and sometime in the material world. Then we serve more and material world activities become reduced. And then one day comes that we become absorbed and really start relishing the real life, that is service to devotees and Krishna. And that time our fortune really begins, when we really learn and become convinced that this is the only life that we have. And what happens in the process when we get purified? Prabhupada explains that our identification with our body, whether it is male, female, beautiful, not beautiful, old, young, all these understandings that we have, dualities and duality understandings, are naturally wiped off. We remain in the same body that we have, but the attachment and the understanding that we have about ourselves as so and so gradually goes away. And that's a happy condition. The more we are detached from our false identity, the more happy we are while we are living in this world. What to speak, when we are young, we feel we are so enthusiastic, we want to jump from here to there, want to run from one place to another, and same thing slows down when we become old. As we progress in our age, then when we get down from the steps, we are slowly getting down. Maybe we take support of somebody. Or when we bow down very slowly because there's a backache. So, first a person becomes old by his mind, and then body becomes old. And if the mind is still young, then the old age still doesn't affect because we are not feeling that we are old. So all the whole exercise is spiritual at the level of soul. And when the consciousness is favorable to our purpose of life, then life becomes happy. If our consciousness is not favorable to the purpose of life, then life is always miserable. And birth, old age, this is death, adhyatmika, adhidaivika, adhibhautika, miseries will be very, very strongly prevalent upon us. But if our consciousness becomes favorable to the Lord, the same things which I explained, 4 plus 3, 7 things will lose their effect on us. Although they exist with their full strength, but they fail to create effect on us. So with this, when I was reading this transformation, man, woman, man, woman, then 1 month, 1 month, I was remembering stories where in the history that people have transformed from one linga to another linga, one sex to another. First one comes to mind is Sri Krishna himself. He goes to Barsana always in the gopi form, Shama Sakhi. And he's so happy being the Supreme Personality of Godhead, the enjoyer of everything, the master of everything, the control of everything, the creator of everything. Still he wants to become servant of his devotee. And to please the devotee, the Radharani, he wants to assume a female form. He dresses himself as Shama Sakhi and goes unlimited times to Barsana and pleases her and her friends in unlimited variegated way. So our Supreme Lord, in nature he is male, right? Because he is controller, he is the enjoyer, he is bhokta, sarva loka maheshwaram. But still, he does not mind to become a so-called enjoyed personality, that is female, for the pleasure of his master, that is Radharani. So we have to learn from our Supreme Lord, because he is himself teaching us that he himself wants to become servant. His mood is to become servant of his devotees, and he, n number of times in Braj and out of Braj, he has proved that he is always eager to become the servant of his devotee. That means the Supreme Lord, the Bhokta, Sarva Loka Maheshwaram, wants to become the enjoyed of his devotees. He wants to become the enjoyed person from his devotees, for his devotees. Then comes Lord Shiva. Lord Shiva heard that Lord Krishna is going to perform Rasleela. So he came running from Kailash with Asuri Muni. There was one more Muni who had performed 60,660 years of tapasya. And he was always having darshan of the Lord in his antachakshu, inside the heart. And sometime it stopped. So he opened his eyes and he was wondering where the Lord is. So he searched the Lord everywhere, right from Vaikuntha on the material world, that is Shvetadvipa, then he went to Brahmaloka, then he went to Kailashloka, then he went to Vaikuntha, he didn't find Lord there. Lakshmi said he has gone down, then he went to Goloka, then they said that Lord has gone down to a material world, earthly planet, where Prishnigarbha and Vamandev have appeared. In that planet, he had gone to perform Raslila. So please go there. So he came down to Lord Shiva again. And Lord Shiva said, I was about to go because I was also very eager to see that Lord is going to perform Raslila. So both of them, can we come together? So they went together and they approached the door of Rasamandala. And they were just going inside with eagerness. So Lalita Devi, Vishakha Devi and other confidants, they stopped. Both of them said, where are you going? Said, we want to see the Lord in Raslila. Said, no, you cannot go because you are in male body. Only one person is male here, everybody is female. Now see, I always imagine this, if I am told, for the best of the benefits in my life, the ultimate purpose of my life is getting fulfilled. If I have to become female and accept a female body, then that best of the purpose of life is fulfilled instantly. Will I be eager to accept that proposal? Will I say, take some time to think about it and come back again? That is our position. But Lord Shiva didn't even in next lover, that is 1/12 of a second, didn't think about it, ki how I should become, how I will become a female, what will my wife Parvati think, what will my disciples think, what will my confidential associate will think, what will be my position, will it be very embarrassing. All these thoughts will come to our mind, but it did not occur in mind of Lord Shiva at all. Instantly he asked, how to become a female? And instantly, looking at the eagerness, answer was given, go to Mansarovar and take bath. And as soon as he heard that, he didn't even wait for a moment over there. He just ran, jumped across Jamuna, went inside Mansarovar, took bath there and attained a beautiful gopi body. And there also, both of them did not think. Instantly, when that body was achieved, they ran back across Jamuna and came again to the Rasamandala gate. And Lalita Devi, Vishakha Devi and the other girls laughed like anything. Why they laughed? Because they saw a beautiful girl coming, having so many snakes around. Because the snakes did not have that desire to enter Raslila. Or the snakes didn't want to become a gopi or a female. So the snakes remained snakes only, even after taking bath in Mansarovar. And Lord Shiva, who was eager in his consciousness to serve the Lord in that particular fashion, and this was the uniform required, so he achieved that uniform of a female body. So Lalita and Vishakha was so impressed that they decorated Lord Shiva themselves by their own hands into a beautiful gopi, and they were allowed with hand. Now they are girls, now they are beautiful women. They are taken inside and given chamara, and they took them inside right where Radha and Krishna were seated in the middle of Rasamandala on a jeweled throne, Ratna Singhasan, and they were enjoying the beautiful company of all confidential servants and the atmosphere of Vanshivat Rasamandala. And there both of them did Chamar Seva and beheld the beautiful forms of the Lord with their cups of their eyes and drank that nectar and satisfied by serving the Lord in the middle of Rasamandala. So very significant pastime to meditate that how much eagerness Lord Shiva has. He has no taboo, he has no complicated mind inside which think, why should I become female? I'm Mahadev, I'm not an ordinary person. I'm not an insignificant resident of the Devalokas. I'm a topmost resident of Devaloka. Mahadev. Although Brahma gave birth to him, Brahma worships him. Such a position he has got. But what is important in this whole story is that consciousness that Lord Shiva had. He had no hesitation at all whatsoever. Even to say Shiva having or not having hesitation, even that is also not correct description, because there was nothing like hesitation. There was only eagerness. There was only efforts in connection with that eagerness. And that eagerness was not to become a gopi, but to serve the Lord. And whatever was necessary to serve the Lord is okay for me. And then he went to Barsana one day. You know, in Barsana, every single great personality comes to call Radharani, to call for her mercy, chant her name, to call her. So Lord Shiva also went there. And they all know that we want to go to Barsana, we have to assume a female form. So Lord came to one pond, Lord Shiva, and he was dressing himself as a woman, trying to dress himself as a woman. But he was unable to dress himself as a woman successfully. So Parvati Devi appeared there, Gauri Devi. And when Gauri Devi appeared, her golden effulgence spread everywhere. That's why that kunda is called Gauri Kunda. It's also called Bihar Kunda. It's also called Maheshwari Sarovar. So then she said that you men don't know how to dress up as a woman. We will teach you. I will teach you. So she dressed himself. That time also, he didn't have any embarrassment. Yeah, my wife is dressing me as a woman. She dressed him as a beautiful gopi. And she said, now you please go and call Radharani. And she also went with him to call Radharani. This is life actually. Absolute no hesitation, no questions when it comes to serve the Lord. What needs to be done has to be done. There is no taboo, there is no attachment to a particular, I will do this seva only. I can do only service when I am director. I will do seva only when I am the prominent personality in the institute. The attachment is to service, not to the position or the kind of service that we do. The attachment is not to one service, the attachment is to please the person whom we are serving. That is the ultimate goal of service also. To please the person whom we are serving, so whatever service it gives us to please him, I am okay. Even in the everyday pastime of Krishna and Radharani arranged by Vrinda Devi, if you study deeply, you will understand the same gopi is not doing same service every day. Although she is known as expert in cooking like Champaklata, but you'll find different leelas. She is doing instrumental playing also. Some days she is dancing also. Some days she is making garland also. Some days she is cooking also, as per her expertise. But although they are specialized, all gopis are specialized in some service or some group of services, like Lalita Devi. Many services she is specialized into. But she also will do, as per Vrinda Devi's planning, whatever is needed. She will not say, hey, don't you know I am expert in making tambul? Why are you putting me into dancing today? No, whatever is planned to please the Lord, that plan to please the Lord is acceptable for people like gopis. So we have to understand that our situation and perfection of that situation, existence in the material world, is only to please the Lord. And whatever it takes to please the Lord, it may be pleasant to us or unpleasant to us, we should accept it unconditionally. This is the ideal situation. And when we are able to do that, that time our life is blissful, because that time the soul manifests its nature completely, naturally. That is the beauty of our life. The time we choose to please the Lord in the given service, that time is the ananda factor of the soul is fully manifest. And the time when we struggle in our consciousness, why me, why this service, then the nature of the soul, ananda, is compromised and we get a part of that or nothing of that or full glory of that, depending on our consciousness. Then I remember the story of Narad Muni. Narad Muni went to Raval, had darshan of Radharani, and then he told Radharani, I want to also see you with your Ashta Sakhis. So she told him that you go to Kusum Sarovar. So it is said that from Raval, he went dancing, tumbling, rolling on the ground, chanting the holy name of the Lord. He didn't know when he reached Kusum Sarovar. As soon as he reached Kusum Sarovar, Madhavi Gopi and Vrinda Gopi came to receive him. And they took him to Sadan, that is south part of Kusum Sarovar, and they gave him bath. And as soon as they gave him bath, he became Naradiya Gopi. And then Narad Muni also had no hesitation. Hey, what are you doing? What is going to happen to me? I have just come to take darshan. Can I take darshan in the same form? No, the qualification to have that darshan with Radharani Ashtasakhi was to become a gopi. So they awarded him and he was like blessed. He didn't struggle. So they decorated him, her, Naradiya Gopi, very beautifully, as a beautiful, attractive gopi. And both the gopis held her hand and brought her right in the middle in the invisible bridge, which had the whirl of lotus, which had Ratna Singhasan, which had the divine couple sitting over there. And again Narad Muni did Chama Seva. And Radharani blessed him. Because that time, when he saw Radharani and Shyam Sundarji, he also saw the eight gopis on eight petals of that beautiful lotus flower, which is invisible, always present on Kusum Sarovar. So Radharani instructed him, okay, now you stay here only and write Pancharatrika Vidhi. So Narad Muni said, I have a curse from Daksha, I cannot stay more than 3 days. So Radharani said, that curse is applicable in the material world where repeated birth and death take place. This is not the birth and death place, this is spiritual world, this is my home. So in my home, that curse is not applicable. You can stay as long as you possible. So then he accepted, he came back. Again they gave him bath at the southern corner of Kusum Sarovar. He regained his Narad Muni male body and he went dancing and stayed very close by in Narad Van and wrote Narada Pancharatrika Vidhi. So see how favorable these personalities are. What is the greatness that, oh, he went and preached Prahlad, he went and preached Dua, he preached Valmiki, he preached Bhagavad, he preached so many people, how great a preacher is. But his real consciousness comes to test when such conditions occur, which is like a tricky situation. Oh, I have to become female now to fulfill the purpose of my coming here. But the real beauty and glory of their consciousness is revealed in these pastimes. Their inner consciousness is revealed. Preaching is still activity of your speech and knowledge and of brain. It can be still done without being a pure devotee, you know. I've heard this in early days of my Krishna conscious life in ISKCON, that one can give best of all pravachans, perfect account of shastras, and still be a non-devotee. One can be a professional speaker, perfect, he may be PhD in scriptures. He can deliver a perfect Krishna conscious lecture. But in his life, he may be a complete atheistic non-devotee, because we have heard in Prabhupada's many lectures also that there are PhDs in scriptures in Western world who are not even believing in the Lord. There are PhDs in Bhagavad Gita who don't even believe in Krishna as Supreme Lord. They can mesmerize us by their talk and their analysis of Bhagavad Gita. So that is still external. What is important is the consciousness. When that consciousness is favorable, that is where the glory of Narad Muni is fully revealed. As Narad Muni, as a soul, as a son of Lord Brahma. And what a great pure devotee is. He's ready to he's so malleable and moldable that any time whatever needs to be done to serve the Lord favorably, to please Him, is ready all the time. And then comes example in mind of Kamsa. Kamsa went to Barsana, like Sudumna went to Sukumar garden in Mount Meru and immediately turned into female. Same way, as soon as Kamsa came to Barsana area, he became a female. He was so puzzled. He is Chakravarti Samrat, he is then Digvijay. He has thrown Kumulaya Peed from one place to another. Looking at that, Jarasandha came running with his two girls to marry him, I mean get them married. Such a personality. He pounded everybody like Aristasur, Bakasur, Putana, Narakasur, and named them. Everybody became his servant. He very easily pounded them. When Kuvalai Peed came, all the Charan Mushtika, five wrestlers ran away, who were like mountainous wrestlers. But they ran away and Kamsa stood there only. Let him come in, picked up his trunk, whirled him in the sky and threw him back to Jarasandha's Pashu Shala. That means the place where he was supposed to be there. Such a big personality, king of Mathura, everybody from Braj Bhumi pays taxes to him, look at his position, and suddenly becomes female. He starts crying, you know that, as soon as he became female. Because he didn't know how I will go back, and how I will face my ministers and my people, and how I will stay here, because already when he became female, all the baby gopis were around, they were very happy and started clapping. Very good, very good, very good. You're such a cunning person. Such a rascal you are, good that you become female. And he started clapping, they started clapping, so it's very embarrassing. Where to go? Not to go back, not to go in. But he had to continue. And he said that gopis made him do the cow dung making, cow dung cake making. You know that cow dung? Kande, banana. Huh? The activity is very sweet, sweet activity. You collect the cow dung from the cow shed, the urine also is mixed with that, and you mix it with some raj. And you make nice dry cakes and you put them on the tree or put them on tree branches or put some hillock and you wait till it dries and you dry it nicely and you collect it on a nice pot on the, what is that called? Tokri? Carry on the head and go and collect it in a nice Cowdung Cake House. There's a nice Cowdung Cake House with fingerprints. And you collect everything for the year's stock. Then you clean the cowdung, clean the cowdung cow urine from Goshala. You milk the cows. You churn the butter, yogurt. Earn the butter and then melt the butter, make clarified butter, ghee. So sweet activities, like the natural activities of Vrindavan Dham. And you see that without doing any tapasya, without doing any devotion to Supreme Lord, Kamsa had somehow accidentally achieved a body of a gopi. In one sense, is it not a perfection of life? Kamsa said, okay, fine, thank you very much. Here onwards, I am no more Kamsa, I am now a gopi. I can serve under some gopi and try to please my Lord, please Radharani. And that is Barsana, she is the queen of Barsana. Krishna also is running behind her. So finally, I have achieved my goal. Even though I was a wrong person, but I achieved. But it is said, 6 months gopis made him do all this work, but he was crying and crying and crying and only repenting. Why I am here in this particular condition? This is a miserable condition for me. While the same activities were being done by all the unlimited gopis, from baby gopis to elderly gopis, everybody is doing the same activity and they are singing songs and shedding tears. Their breasts are always wet with milk, with love for Krishna. Adult gopis and other gopis are only thinking of Krishna as paramour, and young babies are only serving the cows, and cows are shedding tears, cows are dripping milk from their udders. Such a happy, blissful condition. Only one person is unhappy, that is Kansani gopi. After attaining such perfection, such fortune, why? Because the consciousness is wrongly placed. Like we say, our antenna of television is somewhere else directed. It is not where we want to direct it to. What we want to see is not, that direction is not achieved by that antenna. So this can happen to us also. Biggest of all mercies can come to us, but if our consciousness is not oriented properly, then we may be losing the opportunity. And Kamsa lost the opportunity. Because increasingly, exponentially, increasingly, he was miserable day by day. He was waiting, when I will become man again and when I'll go back again. So after 6 months, he was in utter misery. Everybody is in utter happiness, doing the same thing. And seeing Kamsa in that situation, they're very happy. And then Vrishabhanu Maharaj comes with Radharani and says, please forgive him, you know. Anyway, we go to pay taxes to him, he is our master anyways, you know. We don't want to embarrass him any further. Please bless him. Please forgive him. So Radharani warned him with a raised finger, ever you come again, you will become permanently a woman. Now you take bath in Kishorikund. This happened in Jawat. There is a Kishorikund, beautiful place. Take bath here and attain the body. And never you or your person should come back here again. That's how she assured that in that area of Nandagaon, Varsana, Javat, no demon will come. To keep it very away from demons so that all intimate pastimes can be taken place. So Kamsa jumped in the water, instantly attained the male body, and he said he ran with wet clothes all the way to Mathura, not even looking back even one moment, because he was worried if she changes her mind, then again I'll become female. So here we have story of Kamsa. I also remember Kayadhu at this time. Kayadhu was pregnant. Hiranyakashipu was performing tapasya in forest, and demigods defeated demons, and they captured Kayadhu, and she was pregnant. So they wanted to keep her and then let her deliver the baby and then kill the baby, because he's a demon baby. And Narad Muni said, no, he's not a demon, he's a Vaishnava. The baby inside is not a demon. I will take care of her in my ashram. You don't worry about it. Narad Muni is a big authority, so they had to leave. Although they were in a very chivalrous mood, in the war mood, but they had to surrender, they left, and she went to Narad Muni's ashram. Now you see the situation. Narad Muni is speaking about Bhagavatam. Actually to whom? To Kayadhu actually. But the person in the womb is listening. And what is Kayadhu's mood? Oh, when will I get out of this place? When will I leave this place? Why I am here? My husband is in the forest. When is he going to come back and release me from this prison? So although she heard the purest of message from Narad Muni, right, one to one, there is no audience like this, one to one. She could have asked questions, she could have clarified, she could have become a pure devotee on the spot with such a pure devotee association. But her mind was constantly in the thought that, when will I go from this place away? And inside, Prahlad was listening very attentively and he became pure devotee. So much a pure devotee that even though afterwards he was not with any devotees, he could maintain his consciousness and maintain his attitude all throughout time when there was a unfavorable association to him. So finally, what is the message? Message is consciousness. When our consciousness is rightly placed, then all those things, even things which are appearing to be unfavorable in life, they become favorable. Brihad Bhagavatamrita, it is explained, for all those who suffer in this life, all those sufferings turn into the most favorable, happy situations in life for those who love God. This is what is explained in Brihad Bhagavatamrita. All the unfavorable, untoward, unpleasant situations that occur in life turn to be favorable, happy and pleasant situations for those who love God. That means loving God and serving God and pleasing God is an activity which can turn unfavorable situations to most favorable situations for you, for us, for all of us. That's why Prabhupada, our dear Srila Prabhupada, formed International Society for Krishna Consciousness. This is the movement of consciousness, where consciousness is molded, modified, or changed, or transformed. Our movement is about transformation. We are not here to create many thousands of tilakdharis. We are here to create and become ourselves real devotees at heart. Even when we are alone in the middle of the forest, we will remain devotees. Even in the middle of hundreds of people, and we are preaching and giving big lecture, we remain devotee at the heart. Even though unpleasant disease comes to us, we remain devotee at heart. Even though we are living happy and beautiful and healthy life, we remain devotee of the Lord. In all so-called dualities of life, we maintain our inner core favorable to the pleasure of the Lord. Then we are successful in life. Hare Krishna. Is there any comment, any question?
What was the name of Narad Muni when he became transformed as a gopi?
What is the name of Narad Muni when he became transformed as gopi? Naradiya gopi. What is the name of Lord Shiva when he became gopi? Gopeshwar Mahadev. It's there in Barsana, Vrindavan here. Also at Mansarovar. Yesterday we were there in Mansarovar. There is a temple of Gopeshwar Mahadev there also. There he became actually Gopeshwar. And that he travelled, and after that he was beautified, decorated, and then he was told to stay there only. Lord Krishna blessed him to stay here and constantly observe Raslila and guard also the Raslila area. So Lord Shiva stayed there along with Asuri Muni. We don't have any monument of Asuri Muni. But Lord Shiva's beautiful temple is there. He becomes a gopi in the evening. Yes, any question? Yes.
You were giving the example of yourself that you got married and you wanted son. So you got daughter. So in the material life, you see that most of the people, they even your wife, seems that she also wants a boy. But nobody is interested to have a girl.
This is Indian disease. Yeah. I can tell you honestly, it's an Indian disease.
All over India, all over the world also. In the Western countries also, they are not happy. They are not happy. So these things are in the more traumatic nature. That's why this affects us. Yeah. If we can just in the transcendental, spiritual world, we are not in this mood that whether we are done is there or boy is there. Everything is different from material.
Yeah.
So this three modes of material, they are acting on us and they are
all time
disturbing us.
Yeah. If you see how the Lord is looking at us, is he looking at us a male or female? Or a demigod or a earthly man or this man? He's only looking at us as spirit souls, as his children. So when we'll attain that vision, that is called Krishna consciousness. The way Krishna thinks and the way Krishna sees, if we learn to see, then we'll not see each other as men, women. We will see they are servants of the Lord. They're my fellow devotees, my well-wishers and my friends. But at the same time, as long as this body is there, we have to maintain maryada of this body. The rules that our body, demands. Because however transcendental I'll become, I'm still in the male body. So I have to maintain that decor or maryada or rules and regulations maintained by scriptures, ordained by scriptures, to create a beautiful decor, because everybody is not in that situation of life. So even though we become fully realized and we start seeing everybody as spirit souls, still to maintain respect to the order of the Lord, we have to follow all the rules and regulations. Till we leave this body, we have to follow the rules and regulations of this body. Right? Microphone? Yes, yes, you have already have mic.
Hare Krishna, very nice verse. So, according to this Sudhima in complimenting, involuntarily.
In?
Involuntarily, no, not voluntarily.
Forcefully.
Forcefully. So, still when Shiva is a female, that time also the consciousness of male consciousness.
Yes.
But nowadays it is modern medical science.
Oh, I knew somebody will ask this question to me.
So many transformations there.
That is incomplete. What they do in medical science is incomplete. Like they can get rid of the male organ, but you don't become real female.
The yogi power or system when you could transform the female to male, or by a wash or something, she became male to female. Or by blessings of
again.
So now by forcefully or voluntarily becoming female or male. So what will be the consciousness?
Very difficult consciousness. Because you see, if you read the pastime properly, when she was Ila, she was very beautiful and very feminine. When he became Sudhumna, he became very male and very male-like, attracting to girls. And again when he became woman, she was so lusty. And as soon as Buddha proposed, immediately she united with him. So it's like instantly, as soon as the body was changed, that male behavior towards female was there. When as soon as gone to female somebody, the female attractive behavior to male was there. So it is so difficult. Today you are totally a woman, tomorrow totally a man, ruling the kingdom as a chivalrous veer purush. And tomorrow you are a woman doing something else, getting attracted to other men, or having the same feminine attitudes and then manly attitudes. So life was very difficult, I can, at least from imagination I can tell. It's very difficult. It's very easy to deal with one state of life, that is main, and then work on that gradually to detach from that. But day to day, month to month, if we are given different bodies, like such a big, you know, by default program is so difficult to change. The setting is so different. To get adjusted, again start working on that, to get detached, very, very difficult. And it is not explained that Sudhumna or Ila were pure devotees of the Lord. They were not like Narad Muni or Lord Shiva. It didn't matter what body they had. But he was and she was fully involved in the body that they were receiving all the time. So it has to be very difficult. Because even in remaining one state of life, like men or women, also is very difficult because sufferings are there accordingly. And if every monthly things are changing, it's a bigger challenge. That is why, whichever state of life we are in, we have to remain in the association of devotees, so that our track is on one direction, not getting wavered here and there. Bless you. Time. Yes, Prabhuji.
I have two questions. Prabhuji already asked this question. Prabhuji, nowadays we see in Vrindavan, in the kindness of the Arjuna, many seem great devotees, which has their body, yes, and even they dress like gopis, kind of dance, like devotees and sakis.
So what is the question? Don't get, I mean, this is all illusion. Just by wearing a sari, one doesn't become gopi. Please understand. We have to adopt gopi-like consciousness, not dress like gopis externally. This is very important. Prabhupada never propagated such kind of thing. In Vrindavan, very prominently you see, and is also appreciated and glorified. Oh, he is so humble that he has adopted a female demeanor, and he is always dancing in front of Radharani in Barsana. But it's all illusion, actually. We have to work on the process of sadhana to change our consciousness from male to female, the enjoyed one, as a servant of the Lord, to be enjoyed by the Lord. What is the use of changing the dress? You can tomorrow wear a pant and shirt, tomorrow I can wear a sari. It doesn't make any difference. If ego remains inside as it is, whatever ego, what is the use of changing the dress? What will change our consciousness is chanting Hare Krishna Maha Mantra. When we brush the soul with the holy name, then the soul will become purified. And then we can attain our goal of life, not by changing the dress. So, don't take it seriously. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna. Yes.
If at all, we can liberate and go back to Goloka Vrindavan.
If at all?
We can liberate and go back to Goloka Vrindavan.
Haan.
By default, we can go peace.
No. You will get a body there as per your mood that is there inherent in you. That is called as constitutional position. Everybody of us have a Sai Bhav, that is a constitutional nature towards Krishna. Maybe cow-like, maybe cowherd boy-like, maybe tree-like in Vrindavan, or maybe mother-like, or maybe father-like, or maybe gopi-like. That is not maneuverable. That is not planable. It is there within. When you chant Hare Krishna and become purity, that will come out naturally. It is not to be maneuvered. Okay, it's not mechanical. It is there already. So that bhav, when it will become manifest, according to that you will get the body. Maybe of cowherd boy, maybe of a cow, maybe of a peacock, maybe of a tree. Whatever is your consciousness, whatever rasa we will develop. So it's not a plan, it's not a program. It's not a gopi bhava club, you know. The format is there and you become gopi, or the peacock, you will become peacock one day. It's not like that. And one line about this medical, this thing. Again, it's a deep form of maya. To convert oneself physically by operation into so-called female and so-called male. It's all nonsense actually. It's simply a deeper layer, a deeper influence of maya that we come into this kind of modes. I want to become female, I want to become male. But how can we change the hormones inside? We can modify them, but hormones will remain same, beard will keep coming. So, better to live a natural, normal life. And progress naturally, not normally, whichever way we can do. And very humbly and honestly, as a matter of fact way. Not try to manipulate and not try to, you know, maneuver or control the laws of nature and do things what we think we are controllers. Last question, yes.
You spoke about the lecture given to Kayadu by
Nanakani.
And then Pralad Maharaj was listening. But and you said that she was unfavorable audience. When one is giving a class to an audience that is unfavorable, what should be the mentality?
What to be the mentality of whom?
You should continue?
Yes, yes. As long as you speak truth without adulteration, without modification, without manipulation, you should go on speaking. Because truth has its own potency. It can, suppose everybody is unfavorable, it can convert, transform one person's unfavorable condition to a favorable condition. Because truth has its own power. I may not be as pure, but the truth that we are speaking has its power of its own. So, the speaker should always speak, first of all, truth. Not try to adulterate the truth when we are speaking. Speak as per Shastras, as per Acharyas. And continue speaking with same enthusiasm. Prabhupada spoke to all unfavorable audience only when he went to US. Who was the favorable audience? Tell me. But by his purity, by his sticking on the truth, without manipulation, without alteration, without modification, he continued. And then see what is happening today and what happened that time. So transformation will take place. Truth is Supreme Lord Himself. Absolute truth is Param Satya, Sri Krishna Himself. And when you speak on that platform, it will have effect of the Supreme Lord. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare.